we're going to hear more about a particular population for which very little is known in terms of prevalence and incidence, and that's the LGBT population. And so we're very pleased to have Michelle Alcedo here. Michelle, she is the director of Open House, which many of you are familiar with in San Francisco. She has been a lead trainer on cultural humility for over 2,000 individuals regarding LGBT issues and over 200 organizations. And she was recently appointed to the San Francisco Board of Supervisors policymaking group on LGBT healthcare issues. So, Michelle, we're interested to hear what you have to say.
Thank you, Dolores. I think this is fine. Good afternoon, everyone. Great to be here. Have folks heard about Open House before? I'm just going to be very quickly. Great. Wonderful. We love you. Okay. Who we are, for those who don't know about Open House, our mission is to serve lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender older adults in San Francisco Bay Area. And we do that through building housing and providing housing resources, through community programs and direct services. As Dolores mentioned, we also offer tons of training, cultural humility training. We've been doing this since 2006. And we are nationally recognized by the National Resource Center on LGBT Aging, which is now called Sage Care out of New York. Our trainings are typically 3.5 hours long, so this is a very, very quick snapshot of best practices of working with the LGBT community. And then lastly, we are thrilled to partner with the Alzheimer's Association and Family Caregiver Alliance to develop a training on LGBT dementia care. So looking at the intersections of sexual orientation, gender identity, and the issues of dementia and caregiving. So we are super excited about this new training program. A little bit more about what Open House offers in terms of our programs and services. As I mentioned, we offer housing and housing assistance. We built San Francisco's first LGBT welcoming affordable senior housing. Phase one is online, 39 units, and phase two we hope to be online in another couple of years. We also offer LGBT lifelong learning. We have this amazing instructor who is currently teaching Yiddish and Spanish, and we have another person who's going to be teaching French shortly as well. And then exciting news in our friendly visitor program, we train folks to work with and visit folks who are homebound in the community. Exciting news yesterday, we just enrolled a 95-year-old bisexual woman in the program. Yay! So I just want to give a shout out to our LGBT caregiver support group. As far as I know, it is the only LGBT-specific caregiver support group of folks supporting folks living with dementia. That happens at Open House offices at the Bob Ross LGBT Senior Center in San Francisco every fourth Wednesday of the month from 6 to 7:30 p.m. So hope that you can send some of your clients to the group. And we partner with the Alzheimer's Association for that group and have wonderful volunteers and staff who facilitate it. Oops. So what do we know? We know that 20,000 seniors who identify as LGBT live in San Francisco currently, age 60 and older. And we know that LGBT seniors are 5 times less likely to access health and social services compared to their heterosexual peers. In 2013, according to the Department of Aging and Adult Services, LGBT-identified folks accessed, there are fewer than 10% of LGBT-identified folks who were accessing services that were offered through the Administration on Aging. So meals, transportation, in-home care. We're hoping to change that. So unfortunately, LGBT older adults oftentimes face substandard care in care settings in health and social services due to unintentional barriers and to overt discrimination. For LGBT seniors, the experience of exclusion is amplified by these three factors: the forces of ageism, heterosexism, homophobia, biphobia, and transphobia. Many report feeling uncomfortable in senior settings due to heterosexism, homophobia, biphobia, and transphobia, and then ageism within LGBT communities as well. These forces render LGBT older adults invisible in care settings and social service settings. Learning about the concerns and needs of LGBT elders is a health equity issue. Nearly one-third of respondents in a study done by the San Francisco LGBT Aging Policy Task Force found that one-third of respondents reported being in poor general health. Only 15% had children, and of those, only 9% could call upon them for help or who were available to help. 15% of those in the study as well had seriously considered taking their own lives in the last 12 months. And then we also know that LGBT elders tend to be childless, single, and living alone. A study that Open House conducted in 2006 also found that gay and lesbian elders did not have that informal caregiver support that so many heterosexual seniors do have in terms of spouses and adult children caring for them. The ongoing impact of HIV and AIDS. Providers often fail, again due to ageism, often fail to discuss HIV and AIDS with older adults. And very few programs, with the exception of ACREA in New York, really address older adults and HIV. In addition, providers also misdiagnose symptoms as aging-related rather than HIV and AIDS-related and attribute them to normal aging. Many long-term survivors didn't think they would live this long, and so many do not have the means to support themselves and have outlived their fiscal resources. And then lastly, up to 50% of folks living with HIV experience HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder, or HAND for short. FCA has a really great fact sheet about HAND. I think it's out there in the resource table. In terms of transgender elders, there was a study conducted, a national study conducted by Caring and Aging with Pride, a survey that looked at older adults age 50 and older across the country. 2,500 folks participated and found that transgender elders, most likely live in poverty as compared to their cisgender counterparts. Transgender older adults also experience a higher likelihood of victimization and internalized stigma. Trans folks report experiencing harassment and victimization when they're seeking health care. And then not to mention the violence and intimidation they experience just trying to use the restroom that aligns with their gender identity. I recently read an article about a transgender woman who had gone to the doctor to get treatment for kidney stones, which were caused by her prolonged habit of holding in her pee, just to avoid going to public restrooms. So it's no wonder that 44% of transgender elders fear accessing services outside of the LGBT community. And some even travel at great costs and distance to find find trans competent care. Trans elders with dementia may experience distress as well when the dementia advances, may experience stress related to forgetting why they've transitioned or why they have not transitioned. I had one of the oldest women that I met and have worked with for quite a long time ask, "Why am I in this body?" So, what are the concerns brought on by seeking paid care or placement in a long-term care facility? Oftentimes, folks fear inadequate treatment or discrimination or harm based on a history of institutionalized oppression. To avoid this, LGBT seniors oftentimes go back into the closet. The film Jen Silent, if folks have seen that film, also is a really powerful film that highlights this issue for LGBT elders. So fear of discrimination based on LGBT history. Remember those coping strategies of hypervigilance and scanning for clues that an environment is safe to be oneself. It's safe to talk about one's partner, one's friends, one's family. The hypervigilance related to hiding to survive in order to keep one's housing, one's employment, one's family, one's military status. Too often, folks postpone seeking care, which also increases isolation and decreases mental health and physical health. So rather than seeking help from agencies that have historically been unwelcoming, many LGBT elders have turned to our community. You remember the AIDS crisis? That's a huge strength in our LGBT history. Caregiving, we take care of our own. But what happens when one partner relies on the other and they isolate due to fear of discrimination? Then the partner add dementia to layer to that experience. And how many times have we seen the caregiver almost in worse shape than the person experiencing dementia, or not far behind, right? Another note about caregiving is that it's not new to the LGBT community. And, you know, as I mentioned a moment ago, the AIDS crisis, people mobilized caregive for the community. Many caregivers are now finding themselves caring for aging parents with dementia. So just being mindful that it's re-triggering and can be re-traumatizing for folks who may experience, you know, complicated grief related to caregiving again in this role. So what are some best practices for working with LGBT elders? How do we provide person-centered care? Number one, do not assume sexual orientation or gender identity based on marital status, family relationships, or partnership status. I mean, we have heard of folks coming out later in life, right? I mean, one of the most, sensational stories, Caitlyn Jenner, right? Who knew, right? Ask people about how they identify themselves. It's really important that we give people an opportunity, and as an LGBT person myself, the opportunity, I welcome the opportunity to identify myself, my family members, and those who I love. Remember that asking each person how they identify or how they want to be addressed, particularly with the transgender community, is the best way of providing person-centered care and learning about how to best demonstrate respect and inclusion. One incident is an older lesbian expressed her gender as masculine of center and was conserved because of her dementia. Her conservator threw away all of her old clothes. And so when she was placed in the facility, she presents as female, so therefore they take her to the beauty salon and get her hair coiffed and her nails done. And she became combative because that was not her gender expression. Her gender expression was masculine of center, not feminine of center. So that's just one example. Because we cannot see one's gender identity, it's also always important to ask. Okay, so other best practices: provide ongoing training that integrates LGBT issues with dementia care. Place information about LGBT and aging resources in orientation packets and public spaces. This will convey to the community that your agency, your service is welcoming and considering the needs of LGBT elders and their caregivers. Broaden your language in your intake forms. Use partner instead of spouse, or are you in a relationship rather than are you married? Who do you consider family is another way of conveying inclusion. And then lastly, I want to leave you with a call to action. Number one, challenge the assumption that everyone is heterosexual or the gender they appear until or unless they convey it to you. Otherwise, convey it to you. I mean, people have heard of gaydar. Trust me, it does not work, okay? And then things will start to change because there is legislation at the state right now happening around the collection of what's called SOGI data, sexual orientation and gender identity data. So we'll be learning more about the requirements coming from the state. But basically, it's going to require that we collect SOGI data wherever demographic data is collected to understand the needs of LGBT folks in our state. Recognize that institutional oppressions, such as ageism, homophobia, biphobia, transphobia, racism, sexism, and patriarchy, not only impacts LGBT seniors, but their family members, their friends, those who are close to them. Think of a woman in a care facility who's being visited by her grandson, her gay grandson, and his boyfriend. Roommate unhappy about that because of their religious beliefs. So again, folks, we don't know how those kinds of oppressions may impact family members and caregivers. Be inclusive of reminiscence activities to avoid re-triggering of trauma for LGBT seniors. So having many reminiscent activities that include earlier forms of activism rather than, you know, when, you know, earlier experiences of childhood and growing up or early relationships. And then lastly, consider how you might do things differently if you were not to assume the sexual orientation or gender identity of your residents, your clients, your caregivers until they convey it to you. How might you do things differently? How would your language change? How would your materials and your collateral look different? How would your grief support groups look differently as well? And then lastly, I just want to leave you with this case study. Consider Clyde, an 87-year-old placed by his brother in a care facility. And he is watching in TV and is holding hands with another male resident. How might you or one of your staff members react or respond to witnessing that? Just want to leave you with that. So thank you very much. And if you have questions about training, please call Open House.